Hello, Lisa here. Welcome back to my channel. And today we are going to be talking about my top five decks I recommend for shadow work, as well as some of my favorite spreads. And there'll be a little bonus mini haul at the end of this video. So if you are into any of those topics, stick around. I am going to dive right in. So this topic actually came about when somebody requested that I share my favorite decks for shadow work. And I thought I would also include some spreads. And it's the right time of year to be talking about this kind of thing, because a lot of us start doing our shadow work, if we're going to do it, during the darker half of the year. And when we start to get into sort of the October and Halloween season, when the veil starts thinning, it's actually a really potent time to be doing shadow work. Quickly, just so we have a general idea of what I mean, when I talk about shadow work, I'm talking about facing your personal shadow self. The parts of you that maybe aren't so bright and shiny, the things that you may be a little bit afraid of or ashamed of, your fears, the things that sort of lurk beneath the surface that are a little less comfortable to look at. So I'm gonna talk about my top five decks for doing that kind of work. I'm gonna count us up from 5 to 1 with one honorable mention, because apparently I can't not cheat. But so I'm gonna just start. So coming in at number 5 is the Osho Zen Tarot. This would probably not be a deck most people would think of as a shadow work deck. Oh my gosh, there's a motorcycle. And it's so loud. Okay, I think it's gone. Or leaving. So the Osho Zen Tarot comes in for me because it is, to me, a very psychologically rich deck, as well as my home deck, because this is the deck that I started reading tarot with. My copy is trimmed. But it has, I think, a really wonderful ability to call you out on your crap, to point out the things that you really need to be working on. I think that the sword suit in particular does a wonderful job of, like, for example, here with exhaustion. Like, this is a very direct card about running yourself ragged, about having too many things on the go and not making time for self-care. I think that there's a lot of cards in here that really speak right to, oops, whoa. The breakthrough card fell down, that really speak to what you need to be working on. Look at this guilt card. So I found that it was a very potent deck to work with when I was going through my first big burst of shadow work, which, to be honest, that first burst of shadow work I did in my life was around my mid-20s, and it was about 2 years of just facing some hard stuff about myself. So I just found this deck to be such a wonderful tool. I mean, facing your fear of the unknown with the nothingness card. I mean, there's so much here. This card here, politics. I will say that this deck in general does have a slant towards looking at the mind in a less positive light. And perhaps that's one of the reasons why this works so great for me for shadow work. Working with the guidebook and the messages, I do work with the guidebook, the part of the guidebook that is written by the creator of the deck, and not so much the more esoteric-y writings by Osho himself. I read the more psychologically direct kind of messages, and they've been really wonderful to work with. I know these cards backwards and forwards at this point, but I just find that it does a good job of calling you out, and to me that's what I need a shadow deck to do. So number 5, the Osho Zen Tarot. Coming in at number 4 is the beautiful Mary L. Tarot. Now mine is the first edition. My copy is trimmed and I've added the titles of the cards. The Mary L. Tarot is a deep spiritual deck, and I think that if you're willing to go deep with it, it can really help you to dive into the things that you are afraid of, the things that you'd rather not face. I think that it gives you a lot more, I keep wanting to use the word depth, but there's a lot of confronting energy in this deck, and yet I think that it has this undertone of a spiritual quest, of alchemy, of personal growth and spiritual evolution. I think these themes are strong with this deck, and the book just gives you so, so much. The newest edition of this deck is, I believe, matte or semi-matte and gilded in silver, I think. It came out in black edging. And there were some issues with that edging, and then Shipper reissued it. But this is just a really, really wonderful deck. I personally have not been able to bring myself to order the new edition because a couple of the cards were changed, and some of those cards have been absolutely necessary in my personal shadow work journey. and I will show you one of those right now, and that is the Hierophant card. This is a card that really polarizes people. But given the fact that a lot of my personal shadow work has to do with how I perceive people in positions of authority and the way that I respond to authority figures has made that a very, very powerful card for me personally to work with. And so this deck will always be an important deck for my personal shadow work journey. Oh, there's the backs, by the way. Hadn't shown those. So that is number four, the Mary L. Tarot. Coming in at number three, we have the deck, the Bohemian Gothic Tarot by Baba Studios. This is an independently published deck. The full-size version of this deck is currently out of print. I believe they are out of stock on these decks now, but you can still get the mini version, and you can also still get the full-size guidebook, which they recently reprinted, and I do have now. I pre-ordered it when they first released it. This is a very shadowy deck in the sense that it's kind of got this creepiness that runs throughout the whole deck. And I think that that creepy vibe makes it easier to look to the shadow meanings of the cards. And even the little white book that comes with this deck, even if you don't get the full-size guidebook, it's really great for sharing dark. It's got a whole section for each card of the darker shadow or more hidden meanings. So if you wanted to do specifically a shadow work spread, this deck is really fantastic for pulling cards and literally focusing on those darker or more shadowed meanings, especially if you're doing a spread that is about working with your shadow self or getting to know your shadow self or making peace with your shadow self. So really fantastic. I did a conversation with my shadow self spread, which I will link up in the cards, that I did last October with this deck, and it was really meaningful and special. So yeah, this one will always have an excellent ranking for me when it comes to decks that are good for shadow work. Coming in at number two is a deck that was new to me earlier this year, and it is the Heal Yourself Reading Cards, and this is the only non-tarot deck that I have in this category, so I should probably make sure I don't title this video Top 5 Tarot Decks, and just call it Top 5 Decks for Shadow Work. If I screw that up, consider this my disclaimer that that's what I meant. Hopefully I'll actually remember, but I do have the memory of a goldfish, so like, you know, one end of the tank to the other and I've already forgotten. But anyways, I stumbled upon this deck at one of my local metaphysical shops, and once I started flipping through the cards, was like, oh my god, it's like a shadow work deck. This literally feels like what it is meant for, and so I use this deck regularly as part of my spiritual practice. I pull a fresh card every full moon currently so that I have a card to work with for an entire moon cycle. The box is really nice. It's one of those like magnetic flip open with a little nest for the cards. It's a Rockpool publishing deck. It comes with a really beautiful full color guidebook. And let me give you an idea. The artwork is a little bit body beautiful, but this one is really, really gorgeous for shadow work because every single card is essentially a shadow work kind of theme. Some exceptions. Help from Above to me is more about leaning into faith and giving up control. So for me, that's how I worked with it in a shadow work way. But most of these cards do help you to face issues that you maybe want to look at or work on. And I really find it to be extremely effective for that purpose. And just to give you an example, so yeah, take off your mask. Look at this, selling out, like hello. I just think it's really, really good. Unleash your creativity. But then you have cards like Hole in the Soul, Courage, Procrastination. I mean, fantastic for shadow work. And especially if you don't know where to start with shadow work, a deck that guides you in a very blunt, direct way like this, like you can't pretend that this card doesn't say self-love. And if you pull this card for part of a shadow work single card draw, you can't ignore that obviously you need to work on your self-love, right? So I think that that's what this is really good for. If you are new to shadow work or you're not sure where to start, I think that this is excellent. With tarot, it's a little easier to sort of loophole and skirt around the message that maybe you're getting that you need to work on. Whereas with this, it's extremely direct, and I really appreciate that. And the guidebook makes it really, really easy because it literally gives you an action to take. So for example, in the Patience card, the single line message, you must develop patience in all areas of your life. The action, focus on one thing at a time. Say to yourself, I accept what is without judgment. I am willing to practice patience and presence. Breathe slowly and deeply while focusing on what is. Be aware of the air hitting your nostrils and lungs. Soften and relax. Be the explorer of the present moment. Discover what is magical, beautiful, and serene in the moment. If you are feeling unwell or stressed, just allow yourself to explore these feelings with the awareness that they will pass. And there's also a full message here as well. So it gives you exactly what you should be working on and then how to work on it. And then how to work on it. So it's really, really fantastic. I've been working with this with every moon for, I think, 4 or 5 months now. It could be a little more or a little less, but I've been really enjoying it. And coming in, so this is number 2, the Heal Yourself reading cards. And coming in at number 1, which will probably not be a surprise to you if you've been watching my channel for a while, is the Deviant Moon Tarot by Patrick Valenza. Oh my goodness. This deck, I feel like in many of the cards, it literally illustrates the shadow side of that card in such a beautiful way. This is a deck that people have a visceral reaction to, and I think that's really an interesting thing to explore, because a lot of times the reason that we're turned off, at least in my personal opinion, I think the reason that I was turned off by this deck for so long is that it is so confronting. It does show you the shadow side of a lot of these different pieces of life, these archetypes and these experiences, the things we shy away from, the things we don't want to look at, the things that make us a little bit uncomfortable. And I think that this reads fine in the light. However, I always reach for this deck first when I'm doing a shadow work spread or any kind of wanting to get a direct message about things that maybe I'd rather not think about or look at or talk about. This is the deck I reach for because I know that I'm going to see what I need to see in these images. Oops. Whoa. There goes part of the deck. There we go. I did it. For a long time, I was very vocal in Facebook groups about saying that this deck would never be for me. It just made me really uncomfortable. It creeped me out a little bit to look at it. And now it is easily one of the decks that I can't live without because it just does what no other deck does for me when it comes to shadow work. So this is my number 1 pick for shadow work. This is, by the way, the borderless edition. You can get it in a bordered or a borderless. Pardon my doggos. And there is a really pricey but beautiful looking hardbound, like coffee table style book about this deck that you can purchase. I have not gotten off the fence with that yet, but I probably will at some point. Either way, this is a super valuable tool in my personal toolkit, and when it comes to shadow work, I would not be without this deck. So that is my top 5. I do want to put in an honorable mention to a deck that I think is currently out of print. You may still be able to get your hands on it. It is a deck that I work with every dark moon, and it is the Dark Goddess Tarot by Ellen Lorenzi Prince. I love this deck. And art-wise, I probably could live without it, to be completely honest. But there is something about the representations in this deck and the way that the guidebook is written, which you can purchase the electronic, the mobile app for this deck, which has the full guidebook. And the messages and information about each goddess just speaks right to my soul. So I love working with this as part of my Dark Moon practice. It is really the essence of my Dark Moon practice every month, and I really enjoy working with these goddesses and with the messages. It's just very poetically written, the guidebook, and I feel like I also learn a little bit about these different divine archetypes, and it's just been really special as part of my personal practice. Honorable mention, because I think this is the least accessible when it comes to shadow work, the hardest to learn, that sort of thing, and I also think that because it's out of print and a little harder to get, it just wasn't fair to put it up in the top 5. So that is my honorable mention. I did say that I was going to talk about spreads as well. So I'm going to share with you a couple of my favorites. So one is by me and the rest are by somebody else. So the first one is the one that I created when I did the Self-Worth Saturday topic on shadow work, which I will link up in the cards. And that is the Observe, Own, and Create Conscious Change spread. It is a 3-card shadow work spread. The first card is about observe, so it's about what aspect of shadow should you be paying attention to right now. The next one is own, and that position is about how can you own that this is part of the work that you need to do. And the third card is about creating conscious change. What should you be focusing on in order to make progress when it comes to that particular area of your shadow? Another 3-card spread I wanted to share that I recently used and had a wonderful experience with is Poison Illness Antidote. And this is by Unmasking the Divine on Tumblr. This was really wonderful because first you look at the poison. What is the thing that is making you not your best? What is that shadow aspect again to look at? Illness is how is it manifesting in your life? How is it presenting itself? What are the symptoms? And then antidote is how to work on it. And it was just really potent and easy to remember the 3 spread positions, and I really loved working with that one. The third one is shadow, soul, or light, and balance. And so you look at a shadow aspect of yourself, a light or soul aspect of yourself, and then how to balance those two. A 5-card spread that I really like, and I'm just gonna pull it up in my traveler's notebook where I keep my spreads, is called, yeah, it's just called shadow aspect spread. Ooh, my pages are sticking together, there we go. Okay, so here's what this one looks like. You can find this image if you Google shadow work spread or shadow aspect spread and pull it up. I printed it out and put it in my journal here, but the 5 positions are, first, the nature of the shadow aspect. Second, the current relationship to the shadow aspect. Third, the work to release the shadow aspect. Fourth, the quality to embody to facilitate that release, so sort of the positive work to do. And then 5 is the outcome of the work. So that's really good. And the last one, I've already linked to this spread in the cards by now, hopefully. But it is the conversation with your shadow self spread. I guess it's just called shadow self conversation spread. And this one is by Arcane Mysteries on Tumblr. And I've pasted it into my journal here, but this is what it looks like. It's this shape. And these are the prompts. I will link to the video where I did this spread last year. I really like that one as well. And so that gives you some 3-card spreads, a 5-card, and the shadow self conversation is a big 10-card spread. So it gives you kind of a range to play with. I also said that in this video I was going to do a short little mini haul just to lighten the mood because shadow self stuff is, well, shadowy. But before I jump into the haul, in case you're jumping off here, I just wanted to say that shadow work is, I think, a really important part of a personal growth path. And if you're feeling intimidated by it, just tiptoe your little baby toes into the pool of the shadow and explore a little bit. But also make sure that you have lots of support around you, whether that is personal support in the form of friends and family, or whether that is professional support when it comes to having a counselor or a therapist, or whether that is in the realm of just having some self-care or aftercare processes or practices that you can lean into if you've been doing or plan to do some shadow work. Make sure that you are feeling safe, comfortable, and that you don't take on more than you're ready for. I think that's really important. Some of this stuff can bring up some intense feelings, and I think it's important to know your limits and to only explore within what you feel comfortable exploring. And just take your time. You don't have to do it all at once, right? So, now I'm gonna jump into my mini haul. So, Peggy recently took me to David's Tea. And this is, I feel like I'm blaming a lot of things on Dustin lately, but I'm gonna blame this one on Dustin for sure. Dustin is Modern Metaphysic Man. Check out his channel. But David's Tea recently came out with their Halloween collection. So Peggy took me there and I may have picked up just a few things. So the first thing is this really gorgeous color-changing mug. My color's fading because my tea is cooling off, but this part here actually lights up or turns color when your tea is, or your beverage is warm. This is one of their Nordic mugs, so it actually, oh, I just dripped condensation, but that's okay. It actually comes with a stainless steel mesh filter that you can use to brew your tea. Mm. And I am drinking in my mug today, pumpkin chai, which is delicious. Mind you, I do add vanilla flavored creamer to pretty much all of my teas, but this one is really yummy. And that came about because I purchased their Halloween taster sampler pack of teas that came with 5 different teas. So I'll talk about those real quick. So I got the pumpkin chai, which is already almost gone. And I think the way that I brew tea, I'm gonna have about 3, actually this is my 3rd mug and I've got enough here for 1 more mug. So 4 mugs, if you like your tea strong, 2 to 3 mugs of tea or a pot is what you get in here. But this one is really yummy. It's like a black tea. But it smells like dessert. Like it's really yummy. It's not pumpkin spice. I guess it is pumpkin spice, but it doesn't smell or taste like a pumpkin spice latte. It's more chai than that and more creamy than that. But that could be my creamer, so you know. The other teas that come in here are Monster Mash, which is pumpkin butter and cinnamon. This one I've tried, not my favorite. It's kind of weak tasting. And the ones that I haven't tried yet are S'mores Chai, which I'm desperately hoping I love because I love s'mores and I love chai. So I'm excited about this one. It comes with Magic Potion, which is a color changing blue raspberry. I'm dubious, but it won me over with color changing. So that'll be fun, even if I don't like it that much. And Forbidden Root, which is cleansing nuts and roots. So that's exciting. If you have a David's tea in your area, you might want to snap this up. I think all 5 teas were, I think the set was $25, so you get 5 teas for $25. But the most exciting part, okay, maybe besides the mug, because I'll have that forever, is the Witchy Countdown Calendar. Oh yeah. Now, I know some of you might have feelings about this because it is commercializing the witchiness, but I freaking love it, and I think they did a beautiful job. But it's basically a David's Tea, like, adventy calendar for leading up to Samhain. I was so excited about this because, firstly, I love advent calendars at holiday time because I'm basically a child, and I like opening the little doors every day, and so I get to do that for 10 days leading up to Halloween, which at the time I'm filming this, it's not time to start it yet. But look at how beautiful it is. You get 5 little tea sachets and 5 little tea infused chocolates. So it's just a little treat every day for 5 days leading up to Halloween. So our days are, oh, it doesn't actually have the days marked, but this is so cool. You have the serpent, the raven, healing, Laloon, the moon, the future, mindfulness, ace of cups, vision, rebirth, and la nuit, which I believe is the night. So each of the doors is labeled. It'll be really exciting to find out if what's inside thematically matches what the door said. That'll be really cool. So I'm really excited to dive into this, and you can see that it's basically the same theme. This mug, by the way, also has, I don't know if you can see, I'll see if I can show you. It's got like a gold kind of inside. And this tea is delicious. This is the pumpkin chai, in case I didn't mention it. So that is my mini Halloween haul. That was super fun. Thank you for hanging out with me to talk about shadow work. It was really fun. I hope that this helps the person who requested this video and gives them some ideas and some resources to play with. And I will talk to you all again very soon. Remember to like, share, subscribe. If you want to book a reading, visit me at supportivetarot.com. And I'll see you all again very soon.